So I've just gone through my entire opening spiel with the mic turned off. And I wouldn't know that necessarily if you weren't in the room. At some point I'd look over and I'd notice that the mic was off. But oh man, where is the professional, huh? Anyways, what I might do is I will go back and I'll edit this before putting this on YouTube. I might go and rewind myself and do the spiel again. Let's do that one again. Alrighty, sup folks, Voxel Vagrant here. I'm taking you through a very quick Unreal Engine tutorial on how to add assets to your very first Unreal Engine project. You may have heard of Unreal before, or you may have just always wanted to do something in 3D. You could be adding 3D elements into the background of a shot. Maybe you just want to have something to use as reference for an illustration. You could be wanting to do a little 3D animation movie or still, or maybe even start working out the ideas behind a game level. I mean, there's so many reasons why you might want to use Unreal Engine, but for whatever reason, you haven't taken the plunge or the size of the engine and the depth of how much, you know, you can learn about 3D has made the task too daunting. So I'm going to hopefully help with that today. And we're going to go right to the very beginning, the very basics, where you go to find Unreal Engine, where you go to find assets to add into a scene. So for example, what we're looking at here is we're looking at a couple of free assets that are currently available on the Unreal Engine marketplace. And right now, the free assets of the month includes this lovely winter scene with a lovely little lake. And one of the permanently free assets is this really cool looking Kraken guy who's just awesome. And you can imagine the scene is like you're coming through the forest and then you're accosted by a land Kraken. You know, you heard about Krakens from the sea. No, this is a land Kraken. Hangs out with the dryads and listens to jazz. It's the story I've come up with to explain why a Kraken's sitting in a puddle. We've got a Kraken, which is a different marketplace asset. I've brought the two together. I'll briefly talk about being able to set up and frame a shot and very, very, very briefly cover bringing it into something like Sequencer so you can load up its animations. Also check this out. This is so cool and I've got to show this off. Okay, so there's two animation tracks right here. I'll hover my mouse over it. And one is an idle animation, which is this one that we're watching here. And the other is this get hit animation. If you watch the Kraken really carefully, you can see this jump between the two animations as it jumps from one to the other. But watch this. This is like magic. Okay, so I've just dragged one animation track on top of the other track. That's all I've done. And now there's no more jump. The two animations blend together seamlessly. What? What? How crazy cool is that? I just had to show that off. That's one of my favorite features of the engine. So we're going to go through where to find the engine in the first place, what happens when you're downloading and installing it. And then I want to take you through a few different ways to add assets into a project like this. So starting with marketplace assets, let's say you found a couple of cool assets, Winter Forest and a Kraken, and you just want to bring them together into one shot, one scene, for whatever the purpose. Could just be background, could be doing a little clip for a music video that involves a land Kraken sitting in a puddle. Who knows? So that'll be straight from marketplace, which is fairly straightforward. Then I'm going to show you how to transfer an asset from one project to another. I've got this really cool Crusader dude with a nifty animation who he came from Turbosquid originally, and I've already cleaned him up. And he's in another project ready to go. And I'm like, oh man, what if the Crusader is wandering through this forest trying to find jazz dishing out dryads to jam with? And he comes across this Kraken. And a musical duo is on the cards. You know, this is the next great musical love affair. So I'll bring him over from another project. Just had to migrate an asset from one project to another. And then finally, the last thing I wanted to show is how to bring in assets from a third party. So whether that third party is something like Turbosquid, or you've hired an artist and that artist has produced an asset for you and you want to bring that asset in. So there are a few different things that we'll cover very, very rapidly in the short time I have before I pick up Chaos Le Chub, the Bubba. All right, so starting with, let's go figure out how to download our project and what happens when you do, where it goes, et cetera, et cetera. All right, so let's say you are not looking at SoundCloud. You are instead going Google download Unreal Engine. Unreal Engine, the most powerful creation engine. Download Unreal Engine. Just go that link right there. So on your download page, it's going to ask you, and you can get to this from anywhere on the site, from the download button in the upper right-hand corner. I keep forgetting I can't just point at my monitor. I've actually got to highlight it with my cursor. So you'll come to this download page. There's a couple of licensing options. I recommend going with the creator's license because it's free. You can do everything that we're about to do for free. When do you worry about the publishing license and sharing royalties and making payments? That's when you are publishing an actual product like a game. You are releasing a game which has a price tag, and the engine you use to build that game is due a cut of that price tag, frankly. So that's not us today. Right now, we're just artists making cool stuff. And that's the creator's license. So you go download now, and you would download that. And what you're actually downloading is you're downloading the Epic Launcher, which I'll show you. So let me exit out of this project currently. I'll show you what the launcher looks like. Again, I'm trying to take you through this, assuming you've never done 3D before, or never at least never used Unreal Engine before. Maybe you've done some 3D or not, but this is a first time absolute beginner's intro. Okay, so here is the Epic Games launcher. Now, if you've purchased some games from Epic Games, it's equivalent to the Steam store. Your launcher might look a little bit different, and that's probably because you're in the Epic Games section. You want to be in the Unreal Engine section, which is on the left-hand side of the launcher. It's that second option down. You'll know that you're in the right place if you can see the tabs across the top. UE4 tab, Learn, Marketplace, Library, Twinmotion, and UE5. First of all, the UE4 tab, always worth it to see what the weekly webinar is going to be. So there's a webinar with the Unreal devs and creatives who are using Unreal Engine every week. Thursday for people on the Northern Hemisphere, generally Friday morning for folks like us in Australia. And they are always gold. They're so good. In fact, this particular one, the artist on the right-hand side is a well-known motion capture artist who's been producing this very cool character through Unreal Engine. So I'm looking forward to this one. Anyways, the next thing I wanted to point out to you is where you actually get your engine in the first place. I've got my launcher. Where do I go to get the engine? Funny you asked. You would go into the library tab. So library is where you will find your engine. It's where you're going to find your projects and any assets that you happen to own. I always have to do this. I own so many assets. Okay. So if you've never launched Unreal Engine before, this whole space will be blank. All you need to do is press this little yellow button, and it's going to select whatever the latest full version of the engine is, which will be 4.2.7. Version 5 is an early access. You can elect to go check it out, but I recommend you start with 4.2.7. It's stable. All the features are there, and everything you learn in 4.2.7 is translatable to Unreal 5. It's just the interface is different, but all the how things work and the philosophy behind how it's all been built will be the same. So, all right, we have our launcher. We've installed our engine. I'm assuming, like, we're pretending, we're playing make-believe at the moment that we've installed our engine. I would give it a couple of hours if you've never installed it before. So it's been a few hours. We installed our engine. Now I want to find some assets to play with. And this is where we go to the marketplace tab. Also, for folks who are hanging out in chat, I am going to be talking a mile a minute as I want to get through this before Chaos Lichub needs to get picked up from daycare. But if you have a question, please don't hesitate to drop it into chat. I may finish my thought and I might like go blah, 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 and then come back to your question and answer that. So please don't hesitate. And any and all questions are welcome. If it's too big of a question for this particular stream, I can always cover it in another stream. So to the marketplace we go for free assets. One of the things that, and one of the reasons why I have a stupidly large number of assets, thousands of dollars worth of assets, of which I've paid for some, because in the free section of the marketplace, they've got this free for the month. Every month, they are going to list assets from the marketplace, good assets from the marketplace for free, like this $384 character customization robes and accessories pack. That's $400. And now it's mine forever. It's just crazy. It's just crazy cool. Today we are going to be using the Winter Forest, which for this month is for free. And after this month is going to be a whopping USD $138. It's a beautiful scene though, and well worth it, as you can tell by those, all the really high reviews. So, the other free asset we're using is the Kraken, and you can find him under free and the permanently free collection. It's worth checking the permanently free collection every once in a while. I checked it the other day and realized they'd added a Kraken into it. I had no idea. So they're adding stuff to this collection all the time. All right, so my Kraken and the Winter Scene both say owned, because I've already added them to my cart and gone through the process of buying the free asset. That's all pretty standard. I don't think I really need to show adding things to a cart and buying an asset. You are well versed in that. But once you've actually got the asset, you own it, there's two ways you can add it to your project from the marketplace. One is you can click on the asset. So you can go, okay, cool. I've got the asset in front of me. I own it, so now the buy button has turned to add to project. And you can just click on add to project. But we haven't created a project to add it to. What? Let's go make sure that we've got a project to add this asset to. Because we need to have that. And that's what the whole purpose of this live stream is about, creating our very first project. So don't add. I'm pretending we didn't see any of those projects there because, again, we're playing make-believe. I'm pretending that, like you, I have no existing projects. To create a new project, you go to the Library tab. And well, you could actually just go launch up here. But in the Library tab, you've got your engine versions. And on 4.2.7, I'm going to go launch. Now, specifically, we're going 4.2.7 because it's the most feature complete. It's got a lot of features which will be in Unreal Engine 5. It's just in terms of lighting, rendering, and all the bells and whistles, it's a great version of the engine to start with. Okay, so when you are going to create a new project, you will have some, hey, do you want to open an old project? But if you're doing this for the first time, this area will be blank for you. Now on the bottom, you've got four templates you can choose from for opening a project. Now the key difference between these templates is some things have been turned off and some things have been left on, or some settings have been amped and bumped to get a specific quality. So for example, in games, pretty much all systems are turned on because you will turn off and turn on things as you go depending on what game you're making. But the project settings are a lot lower than, say, for example, architecture, engineering, and construction, where the project settings are quite high because you're going for some high-end renders. And that would be the case for the film, television, live events, architecture, engineering, automotive product design, and manufacturing. All of them will have slightly different settings on and off. You can elect to choose any one of them. For the sake of a really pretty image, I would recommend choosing one of these final three. Now, last time I did this, I chose the architecture, engineering, and construction template because it produces some very, very pretty renders. Today, I'm going to choose the television, film television and live events template just because I'm curious personally how it's going to look different. So I'm going to select that template. If I don't like it, I can always create a new project. And we are going to go next. Now, the next page, and this is different depending on which template that you choose. So on the next page, I've got a couple of different options I can choose from. At the moment, I'm going to ignore them all because I just want to create a scene, add some assets to it, take a couple of pretty shots, pretty renders. I just want to visit the woods, see a Kraken, go home. That's it. I can always come back and create a project with these templates later, which I highly recommend doing just to see what's in each of them. So I'm going to create a blank template. Again, it's your very first time. Just make it easier for yourself. If you've never used Unreal before, just create a blank template. Makes your life easier. Okay, project settings. Do we do it with starter content? No starter content. So starter content is basically things like walls, a door, a lampshade that's got an on and off button. It's a good idea to, if you've never done it before, it's a good idea to start with starter content just because you've got some assets to play with and drag into the level and interact with and see how they're put together. But you can also add this in after the fact, and I want to show you that. So I'm going to elect to have no starter content at the moment. We're going to create the project and I'm going to show you how to add starter content in if you hadn't actually selected this. And then ray tracing is disabled. So even if you've got a ray tracing enabled, an RTX enabled graphics card, which I have, I still recommend starting with ray tracing disabled because you want to be in an environment where you've set your settings, you've set your project up, you've maybe dropped your settings from epic down to high, and then you turn ray tracing on. Because if you turn it on while everything's bumped up to the nines, there's a good chance your graphics card is going to crash. And if you've just saved, you're just going to be opening your project on a crashing graphics card every time, and that's really annoying. So just leave it disabled until you make the intentional choice to turn it on. At which point, there are some great tutorials by William Foucher on RTX ray tracing, which you should check out. Okie dokie, artichokey. So moving on. I'm saving my Unreal projects on a space on my D drive because Unreal projects can get very big. Like many tens of gigabytes. So I do not have those saved on my SSD. Mm-mm-mm. And my project name, I want it nice and short. So Unreal likes short project names and it loses its shiznit with long project names. So for example, I might go with something like Jazz Kraken. Nice, short, sweet, conveys the scene and the story. Who else is going to have that particular project name? Create project. Unreal Engine. As I said, one of the first things I'm going to do is reduce the settings, my quality settings just in case. So I'm up at the very top of the UI here. I'm going to go settings, scroll down to engine scalability settings, which are currently on epic, maximum, super high. This is like the same kind of settings that you've got in your games when you turn your settings down and it turns down the foliage and the shadows and the lighting and it just, you know, it turns off a bunch of systems. That's exactly the same thing that we're going to be doing here. So I'm going to switch those to, I'm just dropping it down to high, just dropped it down one level, just a little bit less likely for my graphics card to crash. And the next thing I was going to do was show you how to add starter content, as a content pack, if you hadn't done that during the project setup phase, which gives time for my project to compile shaders. You can't see it because for some reason my editor bar, my start menu bar is hiding these details. Ah, no, my compiling shaders details are on the other monitor. That's why. Okay. So welcome to Unreal Engine. This is the main viewport, your space of play. It's your basically your empty tabletop of which you will be adding all kinds of cool toys. I'm navigating this with basically it's FPS controls. It's WASD to move, so W to move forward, S to move back, A and D to strafe left and right, and I'm holding my right mouse button, and that controls the direction I'm looking as I move. So just like your average computer game first person shooter, precisely the same controls. If you've ever played a first person shooter a day in your life, you'll feel pretty comfortable. So that's just navigating the space, and I'm going to go through things like move and scale and all that once we have some assets to play with. So getting some assets to play with. We're going to look at the content browser. So if you've, you can't see it because my webcam's in the way. If you've opened this for the first time, you probably don't have a sequencer tab here. So let me just close that. Your content browser is probably going to be on the bottom of your UI. And if it's not there, you can go into window and editor, where are you? Content browser. I know you're here somewhere. There you go. Boom. General content browser. And you can actually just open another content browser if you can't find it. So your content browser is basically everything that's in the project. And on the left-hand side of the content browser, you've got the ability to show your project details. So everything that we add is going to be going into here. Now, technically, this content browser is exactly the same as what you would see if you are navigating to the project in Explorer. So I'll just show you what that looks like. Jazz Kraken. So here's my Jazz Kraken folder. Here's the U project, which you use to boot up the project, and the content folder, which is where all the stuff I'm about to add is going to go. So, you could see how technically, no, you actually can't just drag and drop assets into this, because if you drag assets into this, Unreal isn't necessarily going to see them. Unreal turns everything into a .u asset. So the process for adding assets into this project is going to be respective of Unreal turning them into that very specific file type, because I can chuck a bunch of things in here and it's just not going to be visible to Unreal until such time as it's been imported correctly as Unreal needs it to be imported. So that's just showing you how content browser relates to what you see on your computer. So in that content browser, right below the name, you've got this green add import button. And if I click on that, up at the very, very top is add feature or content pack. And on the far right side, there is the starter content that we didn't add during the startup process. So I'll just go starter content. Difference between starter content and mobile starter content is just how heavily the assets have been optimized. So starter content is, it's basically the full assets. Mobile starter content has been reduced significantly to run on mobile, and it's worth checking it out just to get an idea for how to crunch down assets for a mobile experience. Okay, so I've just added that starter content into my project, and this just gives me, so you'll see now that in my content folder, I've got starter content here, and in my file explorer, if I go into content, you'll see there's a starter content folder, just like what I've just added. So that shows you the one-to-one nature there. All right, so starter content's got a bunch of fun stuff to play with, and if you want to see how it all works, go into the maps folder and load up starter map. And this is also a good test to just see what your computer can handle, because there's a little bit of everything in the starter map. When I hit play, so if I'm looking up at all these spheres and cubes, when I hit play, they're all gonna drop. And the audio's gonna turn on, and the crackling and the sparking and the things, and that was very overstimulating. So it's got audio effects, it's got visual effects, it's got physics, it's got materials, it's got pretty much everything that you might encounter. And on these lamps and stuff, I think there's even some code for turning them on and off. So the starter content is just a really great how do things. What do they look like in Unreal? You'll see as I'm selecting things, it updates in the outliner and in the details panel here on the right. The outliner is effectively an outline of everything that's in your scene. And ever since I brought up my accent and did a fake Midwestern accent, I can't get rid of it. I'm doing an accent for the rest of the stream, whether I like it or not. As I select things, you'll see it updates in the outliner. So that's how you access what is in your scene. And as you select things as well, it updates in the details panel. So you can see what the actual details of that object are. Okay. But we came here to play with the Kraken and with the winter scene. So we're going to go do that. Let's exit out of this project. We're going to go back to the Epic Launcher and we're going to download those specifically into our project. And then I'm going to show you how to go grab an asset from another project and migrate that over. You could technically probably add assets from the launcher into an open project. I generally like to close the project first just in case there's something that has to happen in the back end. Just in case. I don't really want to introduce any weird corruption into my project by having Unreal open while I'm adding assets. I think that would suck. Okay, so marketplace, and we're going to search for Kraken. And there's our lovely guy just there. And I'll select that asset. And now if I go to add to project and I scroll down to Jazz Kraken, not to be confused with Land Kraken, I can now select that and go add to project. And it's going to take its sweet time, but that's okay because I can show you a couple of other things first. Oh, it's already added to the project, actually. That happened quickly. The other way to add something to the project that you already own is in library. So everything that that is associated with your account that you have purchased, so even the free assets that has gone through the cart and you've purchased them, will show up here in the vault in library. And if you reach the point that I have, or you just have way too many assets, you can just search the vault for what you're looking for. So in my case, it's that winter, here we go, the winter forest. I said the winter forest or the winter forest set? I think it's the winter forest. But just to double check, I'm going to go free for the month. Yes, it is the winter forest by Artem, Raevskii. So you can actually add it directly from your vault. Just by searching for the asset and going add to project. And I would scroll down and once again, I'd select Jazz Kraken. I'm not going to press add right now just because that's a 2 gig download and I don't want you to have to sit here and listen to me talk crap for as long as it takes to download 2 gigs. Instead, we're going to go over to a project I prepared earlier. So scrolling back up, we are going to go check out Land Kraken, which has both scenes already added to it. So we're going to create so we're going to basically scope out a location for our shot in the winter scene, and then we're going to add Kraken to it. I will save the animation scrubber slider for another stream, and we'll just cover off the adding assets one today. Okay, so in the content folder, we've got a few more things now, Kraken, and Winter Forest. VV is my folder, so Voxel Agent, favorite. So we're going to go into the Winter Forest folder, and inside levels, you'll have Winter Forest assets. So this will be all the different assets used in the scene, and Winter Forest demo scene, which is what we saw in the marketplace pack and the one that we want to check out. Waiting for the camera exposure to wake up. So there we go. Lovely little scene. We've got some snow falling. It's all very pretty. And you've got this like cute little pond. Cute little pond that's just begging for a Kraken. That's where we're gonna set up our why is he in the forest? I don't know. I just don't know. I still think he's in search for his dryad jazz companion. Okay, so cool. I've scouted location I'm happy with. Once again, I'm using WSD to move and holding right mouse button just like I would with a FPS game. So here's the location. I like it. I want to save out this level so I can add some stuff to it and come back to it later. And I've still got a clean version of the demo scene. So to save another version of this level out, I'm just going to go File, Save Current As, and I'm going to go into Content, and I'm going to add a Maps folder. So go right-click, New Folder, Maps, and inside Maps, I shall go Land Kraken _00. I use that particular naming convention because for me, _00 means pre-production. This is the scene in which I bring everything together and set it up before doing any shots or animation or anything. And then when I do something with it, like I do an animation or a recording, or I take it to another machine to do other stuff, I'll go version 1 or version 2 or version 3, etc. But while it's just in the setup phase, I go version 00. Okie dokie. All right, so I've saved that. You can see that it's now saved as Land Kraken 00. So I can now go check out the Kraken that I got. So in the content browser, there is the Kraken folder. And there's a few different things here that come with it. First of all is the animations. This is a game's animated character. So if I double click on any of these, it's going to open this little editor window, browser window, which lets me see the animations that come with this guy. So this is that death animation where he goes, oh no, I've died. And he drops to the ground. And these are all the different animations that you can either link up for your games animation, or you can bring them into a sequencer to do a like little animated film, which is what I think we're going to do on the next stream. So that's all my little animations. And also in that Kraken folder, I've got Maps, Content Overview, which is basically just the Kraken sitting in an empty scene. If I just wanted to look at him and go, he's pretty. Materials are the types of material that is on his skin. Again, we should totally do another stream just on materials. I think that would be fun. And finally, meshes. Meshes are the ones that we want to play with. So the mesh that we want to bring in is this very first one. It's got a pink bar underneath, and that's your skeletal mesh. A mesh with a skeleton, and therefore can be animated, because skeletons are what you need to move. So I'm just going to left-click drag this skeletal Kraken into my scene. And when I left-click drag, basically, I haven't let go of the left mouse button yet. I can just sort of like scrub around until I'm happy and drop them. But let's say if I dropped them too soon, and I still want to move him. I just select the guy, so left mouse button to select, and it's W on my keyboard, and that gives me my move tool. And I've got these little arrows on the move tool gimbal, which I can drag backwards and forwards to move in, say, one direction. It said X or Y. Or if I grab the very middle center ball of this gimbal, I can actually just drag him in all directions in full 360 space. So I'm going to drag him over to, I just want him to sit in my little pond here. I want to drop an animation on him just so he's in a pose that I can see if he's going to be intersecting with things. Because like already he's got like one tentacle below the ground. So I need to work with a little bit more information here. Where's the bigger part of the pool? Maybe I should actually move him. So use W on my keyboard for the move tool. To this half of the pool, and I'll rotate him. So that's E on my keyboard for rotate, and I can left click drag on any one of these axes to rotate him. W to move again, and he's just way too big, so I'm going to scale him down. So scale is R, and I can again scale in any just one direction with those single boxes, or I can scale in the very middle and scale him down uniformly in all directions. And now he is much less of a big boy than he was. It was a much bigger boy before. So he's become a little bit less awesome. I think I might scale him up again. Oh man, he's snapping. So when you scale, snapping is currently on. I can turn that off and have more granular control over the scale by turning off this highlighted orange button up at the top. So enables or disables snapping of objects. So if I turn that off, I now can scale him fluidly and with complete control. Okay, I've got a Kraken in the scene, but at the moment he's in bind pose, which means he's just a little bit like, ugh! A whole lot of nothing. So I want to add an animation to him, so he's at least in a slightly animated state. So if I select the Kraken, on the right-hand side in the details panel, I've got this section for animation. So I can actually say I want him to have an animation on him in editor, in, like when he starts, when I look at him in editor. Right now it says it's set to use animation blueprint, which is what you would use in your game. I'm just going to change that dropdown to use animation asset. So I can actually give it a very specific animation to use for framing this shot. So when I've done use animation asset, it's given me this anim to play button. And if I click on the dropdown, it's going to show me all the Kraken animations that are bound to that skeleton. So I can say, for example, grab the idle animation, and you see that's instantly changed his pose. So I now have a much better idea of where he's going to be and how he's going to sit in space. So I can actually, now that he's got an animation on him and it's changed his pose, I can actually drag him to a location that's going to make a little bit more sense. So right now, one of his tentacles is totally under the ground and possibly coming up through the ground. So I might actually rotate him back a little just to raise him, and get that tentacle out from being stuck in that ground plane. Cool. See, we could actually stop here and just go like, oh man, we could totally frame this badass Kraken shot. You might stop here and use this for framing for your artwork. But I do want to show you a few more asset tricks for bringing assets in. So the next one is I want to migrate a character from one Unreal project to another Unreal project. I've got this Crusader in another project, which I think would look really cool in this shot. So I'm going to save this. Just go save all. I'm going to exit this project, and I'm going to go to my other project, and I'm going to migrate him over. Specifically, migrate. That is the function you are looking for. I need to remember to take a breath every once in a while. And to do these recordings on days where I'm not under the pump to go pick up the bubba. Chaos Le Chub. Okay, so I'm going to open up Cruise Control, my Crusader Control project. You are welcome to borrow these names, though you may not, people may realize you're as unprofessional as I am if you do. So let's open this one up. I've got my character guy here. You see he's already got all of his textures and materials applied. But if I go into my content browser and I go characters, meshes, I can see that Cruise Control actually doesn't have any of his materials applied in this. So I'm going to have to make sure that I copy the materials across, as well. Okay. So, I want to bring this Crusader over with his animations and with his materials. They're all in separate places, so I'm going to have to do this one at a time. So we're going to go into content, go into characters, I'm going to go into meshes, and here is my animation for Crusader Animation Idle. There's my Cruise Geo, and here's the random, oh, that's the T-Rex texture I don't need him. So I'll just go see Cruise, so just grab the animation, the skeletal asset, the physics asset, and the skeleton. If you're wondering what to grab, a good rule of thumb is grab everything that's got the same prefix. It's got the same prefix name. If it has the same prefix name, it probably belongs together. So this is just going to grab this. It's just going to grab this untextured mesh. But that's okay. We need that first, and we're going to go get the materials next. So I'll right-click on those, and I'll go asset actions and migrate. That opens up my, by the way, these are the things you are migrating report. And I'll hit OK. And where I'm navigating to is I'm going into my Unreal Projects directory, and I'm navigating to my Land Kraken folder. And I want to select content. Whenever you're migrating an asset, you're always going into the content folder. If you want this to show up correctly, that's where it needs to be. So I've selected the content folder within Land Kraken. Go select folder, boom, migrated. Now let's go grab those materials. So I'll go back up a level into materials. And there is my M for material cruise and the sword. So let's grab both of those. And we're going to right click asset actions and migrate. And you'll see this is one of the things that I quite like about the system. I've got my materials selected, and it's also automatically selected all the textures that are attached to those materials. So it's going to bring all those dependent objects over with it. So I'll go OK. And same deal. So land Kraken, make sure I've got the content folder selected. Go select folder. Whoosh. And it's migrated across. OK, let's shut this project down and go to the other folder. T minus 10 minutes and counting. Okay, library, back to land Kraken. There, it's our boy. Again, even though I'm talking a mile a minute, again, if anybody's got questions, please drop them in chat. I'll either answer it when I've had a breath and finished my thought, or I'll answer it on another stream and they'll all go up on, so any tutorial streams will go up on YouTube. Okay, so in the content folder, I now have this characters folder, which has the materials and the meshes that I just brought across. So let's go back to content and maps. And there's the map that we created earlier, Land Kraken 00. And we're waiting for our camera exposure to wake up. Generally, I'll turn that off just because I find it really annoying sitting here waiting for it to go from dark to not dark. All right, where's our character? He's in the character folder. So content, characters, meshes, and let's bring in Cruise Geo. There's our guy. There's our dude. He's of a great size compared to this Kraken. I think that's going to make for a cool shot. And at the moment he's just in bind pose as well, which is again that like bleh, boring pose. We've got to add an animation to him. So under with him selected and his details panel, where it says animation mode, I'm going to change that to use animation asset. And switch. Now that I have this anim to play option, if I open that up, you can see the one animation I've got for him. So like remember he was included in my migration. If you don't see this, there's a good chance you didn't actually migrate the animation. So you'll have to go back to the other project and migrate those animations. So let's select Anim Idle, and that has gotten him into our starting position. He's currently very much in the ground, so I'm just going to raise him up. But I am, however, going to intersect him slightly with the ground because it's snow, man. His boots would absolutely crunch down into that snow. Oh, it's going to look really cool. Okay, so the next thing we need to do is connect his materials. So I'll select him again and scroll a little bit further down in the details panel. And underneath the materials tab, I've got element 0 and element 1. So that's two material slots. And if you remember, we had two materials. We had M Cruise and we had M Sword. Now they've come in. They looked blank at first, but I just needed to actually open them up. And then they've populated. So one of these is sword and one of these is cruise. I'm not sure which yet, so I'm just going to literally just drag and drop the sword into the main. That's totally not the right slot for the sword. Clearly, element 0 is his material. So we'll drop his material on. Instantly looks better. Instantly looks better. And which means element 1, the second material slot, must be the sword. So I'll drop that on as well. Boom. Cool looking. Cool. That's going to make for a very cool shot. This is super useful if maybe perspective and proportions is something that you're working on and you need a little bit of help. Framing a shot like this in 3D makes it easy for you to see how everything's going to be laid out and get a sense for depth and scaling. Thank you so much, Ferret, that it's looking awesome. It helps that I mucked with these assets ahead of time to see what would look good together. But that being said, these are like just free assets that are available to use. It's crazy the level of quality that you can access for free and if not free, very, very affordable on the marketplace. I've never not been able to block out a shot for something, for a project that I've had an idea for. Okay, cool. So he's got an animation. If I were to stop here and take a screenshot, I would actually, let's say I want to take a screenshot for Paintoverse, right? Right now, there's actually like, I can see these lines in the background, which are my post-process volume. I can see a lot of really gamey stuff. If I had my Kraken selected, I'd see my gimbal. If I want to hide all the gamey stuff, I just go into the little drop-down arrow, which is in the upper left-hand corner of the viewport, and I turn on game view. And that's going to hide all those little gamey icons and gimbals. So I can now take a screenshot, which is nice and clean, and take this into Photoshop and do a paint over, or I might just have it up on my monitor and use it as reference if I've put the scene together as reference for a background and perspective and all that. Obviously, if you're working on an animation or a game, you're just gonna keep working in this. But this, the screenshot function I'm about to show you, so it's the same little dropdown, high resolution screenshot. If I click on that, it's going to say, hello, would you like to take a screenshot? Yes, I would. There's a little camera icon in the lower right-hand corner. Take that screenshot, please. And it tells me, and this little pop-up at the bottom, the screenshot has been saved in projects, Unreal Project, Land Kraken, saved screenshots windows. And if I open that up, you can see that here. So it's taken this nice high-resolution screenshot for me. That screenshot function is also extremely useful if you're working with a client and you just want to give them a screenshot from game. Or maybe you want to take stills for marketing. You want to show off some of the stuff that your artists are doing. You can jump into the engine yourself, find a good looking shot, frame it. And then you've got, really nice high resolution screenshot for whatever the purposes might be. Okay, so we have covered, I just want to make sure I've got enough time to do this. We've covered directly from the marketplace, assets for another project, and I'm going to very quickly show you adding an OBJ and adding an asset from Datasmith. So this is if you've got something from, say, Turbosquid. And then I'm going to shut the stream down and go get my baby. Okay, so if I'm adding an asset from, say, Turbosquid, I'm going to go into Content. And I'm going to create a new folder called Imports. I like to keep everything I've imported from outside of Unreal in a separate place. So I've got my Imports folder. And the thingamabob that I want to add totally has nothing to do with this scene whatsoever. I was going to show you, I was going to create a whole other project and a whole other scene. And I just don't have time, guys. But I do want to show you what I've come here to show you. So I've got this turbo engine thing that I picked up from Turbosquid. And I want to, like I could just say, drag and drop the OBJ into my content browser. I like to just press that import button and go import the game, to each their own. It's basically the same thing at the end of the day. I'm gonna import that OBJ. It's going to give me a dialog box of a bunch of different import options. If you're just using Unreal Engine to create 3D backgrounds for your artwork, the only thing you probably have to worry about here is in the very first section, expand that dropdown. And I'm just going to make sure I turn on combine meshes just for now, because I want to have one object to play with and move around. If I leave that off, it's going to leave all the meshes as separate parts, which you will want to do eventually because you might want to add different materials to different parts of the mesh. But right now, I just want to show it to you. So I'm going to turn on Combine Meshes, and I'm going to go Import. Now, all of those settings and what to change and why, I cover all of those in a video on YouTube, which is specifically about importing animations and importing characters from Maya. So if you want details on that, check that out. But you can also, importing those import settings, you can experiment with. Okay, so it's brought in a whole bunch of different materials. There's basically a different material for every object on the mesh. In my import settings, there's something that says do not create materials. I forgot to turn that on. But the important thing is, this tiny little guy has also been added to my project folder. This is my turbo engine. Check this guy out. How cool is he? And he just looks so pretty in this scene. So this is just a regular polygonal object brought in as an OBJ. This is the process I just showed you with import. It's the same one you would go through with an OBJ or an FBX. And that gives you this straightforward mesh asset that's just like the others. I could create materials for this. I would attach materials to it the same way I attach materials to the character. Now, sometimes you're going to find assets that are a different format. So say, for example, now this asset comes in a data format as well. Something like maybe it came from Rhino or another data visualization program like AutoCAD or something. Where are you, Turbo Engine? So this one has come in a .step format. You can actually import those data type formats from like Rhino 3D or any of them directly into Engine with the Datasmith importer. So up here at the very top, there's Datasmith. I'll click on that. And if I go to that Turbo Engine folder, you see it's automatically showing me only the .step file. So it's only showing me the file that I can bring in with Datasmith. And I'll click on that and go open. And I want to select my imports folder again for my import. And I'll hit OK. Now, there's a bunch of different options that you can experiment with and get better at tweaking for how you're bringing these things in. Basically, the ones to pay attention to are, well, obviously, if you know, I want geometry turned on if I'm bringing in geometry. But at the very bottom, you've got geometry and tessellation options. And if your geometry comes in and it's too heavy and slows the scene down, you can reduce that geometry here. If the geometry comes in too low and it's like got a bunch of sharp angles and you need to add more detail, you can up these settings. I would recommend Googling Datasmith import best settings. There's a bunch of different, basically it's a lot of architects have posted their favorite settings for importing Datasmith objects. So you can try a bunch of different ones. So I'm going to just leave this at defaults for now and go import. And that's going to take a little bit of time. It's automatically jumped me over to where he is sitting in space. The thing to note when I import a Datasmith object, it imports all the different disparate pieces. So you can see he's come in with like a bunch of different materials on him. But it's also brought it in as all different parts. So just keep in mind when you're bringing in a Datasmith object, it's going to bring in all the different bits and body parts. So like I would have to actually go up and I can, fortunately it's grouped that all into one thing for me. So I can just grab the top level group, move him up into my scene, and he's super, super tiny. So I'm just going to scale him up. He is so small. He's just so small, so small. And you can see him there. So much detail has come through. It's a very cool object, this one, actually. Okay. That's it for bringing in assets from different programs. The caveat I'd say with Datasmith is just make sure that you've got a tidy location folder to be importing that. And Datasmith is just a different pipeline to the normal import skeletal static mesh. So it may behave better, it may behave worse. That is going to be very dependent on your project. But that's how you would go about the process of importing, bringing assets into your very first project, whether it's from directly from the marketplace, from another project, from a third party as an OBJ or an FBX, or as a Datasmith object. And if you're wondering whether or not your object is eligible for Datasmith import, the documentation for Datasmith basically lists every format that it accepts. Thank you very, very much for everyone who stayed tuned for that entire stream and me talking a mile a minute to try and get through this in time to go pick up Chaos Lechub. This will be up on YouTube probably later tonight. I'll have to wait for Twitch to post the video up on their end. Yeah. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. Be sure to follow me if you want to catch me online next time. I will I will normally schedule these way in advance and let everyone know when they're on. This is actually a redo tutorial because I figured I could do a better job than what I did yesterday. I'll catch you all later, and you have a great night. I'm going to switch to my ending frame and my closing music. So going over to my ending page now. Hang out for the socials for the ending screen. It's quite fun. And my ending music, man. All right, and...
Computers are supposed to make life easier. About 1 in 3 American households has bought that theory and purchased a PC. But what they didn't tell you is that life does not get easier right away. Computers are supposed to make life easier.